you are not limited to this perpendicular direction. In fact, you can use any other two vectors, two different directions. We can resolve any vector in that direction. So this gives you a method for representing the entire vector in Rn. So for example, R2, how many vectors are there in R2? You can see any vectors in R2. But using the 1, 0, 0, 1, you can represent any vector as a linear combination. So this is known as a linear combination. For making this more general, we will introduce two concepts. For this first concept is span. Linear combination, we will introduce two concepts. First concept is span. So for that we select V1 to Vk is a subset of the subspace of vector space V. So you know what is subset. The span of, I will call this vector S or V is equal to, let V is equal to the subset V1 to Vk. Like we have taken k vectors from that. Then span P, span of P is the vector mod of the linear combination of V1 to Vk. That is, using V1 to Vk, how many linear combinations are possible? All the combinations is known as a span of V. Right? So you take a subset. What is span? You find all possible linear combinations. So that is span. Now if the span is equal to V, I took a subset from V. Set up all linear combinations into V itself. Then we say that P generates, P is the generating vector V. If span P is equal to V, then V is the generating vector. So, which answers the question, like can we find a smaller subset or subset of V such that any vector can be, any vector in V can be represented as a linear combination of that. So you can take any generating set. Now the, you can find that. We have seen that 1, 0, 0, 1. Using that you can find any vector in R. So that is a generating set. Now we will look into some efficiency. So you don't want many vectors in that generating set. What is the minimum generating set? Right. So how can we find out that? Say V is there, V1 to Vk. So is that minimum set? How do you find out that? Is that minimum number of vectors in which you can generate any vector? Very simple set. If one of the vector in that subset, that is V1 to Vk, can be generated using remaining vector. Say, I can write Vk as linear combination of V1 plus V2. Then why should I be Vk? I can call it away because I can generate Vk using V1 and V2. Right? So we have to look into the set, generating set. From that you throw away the redundancy. Throw away the redundancy. For relevancy to throw away. So that we introduce the concept of linear element. Then we introduce the second concept of linear independence. what is linear independence? A set of vectors given to each is actually linearly independent. One of the vectors cannot be represented, any one vector in that subset cannot be represented as a linear combination of remaining vectors. One to VK is linearly independent if any vector in V1 to VK cannot be represented as a linear combination of remaining. Okay, so that is the meaning, that linear dependence. So that you can you cannot take away any vector because that vector cannot be generated with the remaining vector. Then is there a linear independent set. But there is a nice way to put that condition. So we say that V1 to Vk is linearly independent if the sum A1, B1, A2, B2 sum Ak, Vk equal to 0 implies that all coefficients are 0. A1, B1 plus A2, B2 plus Ak, Vk equal to 0 implies that A1 equal to A2 equal to AK equal to 0. So this is linear. So same concept as this, but written in a more rigorous way. So that is, same meaning is conveyed. So a set is linearly independent if a linear combination equal to 0 is possible only if all coefficients are 0. If all coefficients are not 0, what you can write, say if Ak is not 0, you can write, you can take that into the other side, Ak, Vk equal to minus of A1, B1 plus A k minus 1 b k minus 1, then you can represent Ek as minus of A1 by Ak B1 plus etc. to Ak minus 1 by Ak Ek minus 1, right? So you can represent Ek as a linear combination of any vector. So which contradicts the assumption that they are linearly independent. Right? So we get this kind of representation. That is, a set of vectors is linearly independent. The linear combination equals 0 implies that all coefficients are 0. In fact, so that is the concept of linear independence. So if you put these two conditions, that is, a generating set is a linearly independent. So you will get a minimal generating set. So that is for the base. A linearly independent generating set, that is basis. Vector space and the number of elements in the basis of is called the dimension theory. And the number of elements in the basis is called the dimension theory. Basis is called the dimension of the vector. Right? So that is for finite dimensions. If the basis contains the number of elements in the basis is not finite, then we call it infinite dimensional vector. Right? So this is the infinite dimensional vector. So that is the concept of basis in the vector. So we started with the vector space with some properties and two operations. Vector addition and scalar multiplication. Then we came with an operation called linear combination, linear combination of vectors. Then we asked the basic question, can we find a representative set of vectors using which we can write we can find any vector as a linear form. So that is next, okay, that is another span. We look at the efficient span, minimum number of vectors required to span. So then we introduce the concept of linear independence. In the span set, we remove the redundancy. So we get linearly independent span set. So that is called the basis. So which is the minimal number of vectors required for the to generate that vector? So the minimal generation. That is also a maximal linear independence.
You apply DFT, you will get DFT basis representation.
there is another platform, you will get that platform. The Chinese is also a different way to work. In fact, you multiply a vector with an inverse neural metric, that results in a transform. So you want to go back, come back, right? And the inverse neural metric. So you will come to that concept later on. Click on to this linear independence and basic. So that is a very basic concept of the vector. Now we move to another concept. These vectors, we want to give some measure for that vector. Actually, we can compare the image bigger in size, it has more power. Some kind of measure is required for doing that. Then it is useful. That is not necessary. But if you have a measure, so you can compare two vectors, which is greater in some sense, so no inside. Usually, compare the vector like this. These are also some feature vector. What is the important thing? Machine learning, we have the feature vector. We are trying to represent some legal system. So we have a feedback of some features of that. Okay. For example, we are trying to classify some fields. So if from the feature, we have to classify. So what do you see? You can see one measure, maybe the length, right? Width, maybe another measure. If you have weight can be another measure. Or if you have some specific features of this piece, you can have that feature. So all these features we will put this into some numbers, right? Then we want to compare with the other, right? If you have a standard number, okay, so if the new bit comes, you can compare with that standard number. So comparison, we should get some distance better. So this into addition does not give you a comparison, right? So we need something more. So we define what is called as inner product, which gives you the method for comparison between the vectors. This is also not new. Inner product B B greater than or equal to 0, B inner product, B equal to 0, like that B equal to 0. One more is AB inner product U should be equal to A inner product U. So inner product means that is also not a simple definition. You can have different types of inner products also. So every inner product should satisfy these four conditions. First condition is additivity condition. That is, we have two vectors, two and three vectors, which we end up. We want to find the inner product of the sum e plus 2 is w. That should be same as p inner product is w plus q inner product w. Then conjugate symmetry property, that is d and u inner product p complex conjugate of uv inner product. If you change the order, it should be equal to some conjugate. But if you are working with real, so all these four conditions satisfied, you can define an inner product. And what is the most common inner product is that, say, P is something like P1 to be n, and U is equal to U1 to UN. Right, so these are the components. Then we can define EU as sigma I is equal to 1 to n VI UI conjugate. So this is the most used inner product. What we do? So we just multiply corresponding elements. But second element I use the conjugate, E inner product. Second element conjugate, all are added. So that is one inner product, and you can verify that this definition of inner product will satisfy all these conditions. All these conditions, 1, 2, 3, 4, is satisfied by this. But this is not the only inner product, you can have several different inner products. So you can define this kind of summation is possible for R and Cn, right? Vectors in Rn and vectors in Cn, this kind of summation is possible. So Rn and Cn has such inner product defined for this. So you can define the inner product of Rn and Cn. Vector space of total, you can define such an inner product. Not all vector spaces can define this. Better called n-th binary number, like Coase vector space under X4 addition. There we cannot define the inner product. These properties will not be there. So that is not an inner product. So I want to give you that a counter example. This is not useful. I don't know that. So that's the counter.